Hello, good evening if you are in Europe like me, or good morning, good afternoon, good night, good very early morning, depending on whatever time zone you are attending from. Welcome to this webinar from Toradex. The topic of this webinar it's Visual Studio Code, and the title is From Zero to Hero. So in this hour, more or less, we are going to try to give you enough information to get started using Visual Studio Code to develop applications for our embedded devices. I didn't introduce myself. I'm Walter Minute. I am a senior software developer at Toradex. I've been with the company for more than 7 years now. And yeah, it's not just about me, it's about the tools and the company. As you can see, Toradex is a company that has a worldwide presence. Our headquarters are in Switzerland. But we have, as you can see, offices all around the world. Our main product are system of module or computer of module, depending on which definition you like more. And as you can see from this slide, we have quite a wide set of modules, three different families, bin-to-bin compatible between the inside the same family. We have Apalis and Colibri, that are, let's say, our historical products. They've been around for quite some time. And we have our new family, Vertin, that has been announced this year at the Embedded World in Nuremberg in February. Does not mean that we are no longer developing products with the other two families. Each one can fit slightly different scenarios, so it's up to you to choose the product that better fits your needs. In terms of applications, we have thousands of customers in different areas. Industrial automation and everything industrial, but also we have many customers in medical, healthcare, transportation, and so on. Depending on which kind of device you want to develop, we may have a solution that can fit your requirements. We also have our technical sales people and also our field application engineers that can use the product that better fits your requirements. And since this in this webinar, we are going to talk also about Torizon. Torizon, it's our new Linux-based operating system. We have been traditionally offering easily integrating your Yocto builds. But with Torizon, we want to do something slightly different. Basically, we provide a ready-to-use image that you can then use to develop applications on top. What are the main interesting points about Torizon? First of all, it can run containers, so you can package your application as a container. If you're not too familiar about these things, this technology, we did a webinar in September, so you can go to our website and watch the recording. Also in Torizon, we provide over-the-air updates, so you can keep your devices up to date, even in the field. We also are focused on security, and we provide also a real-time version, as real-time as the Linux kernel can be, that can be used for some specific application. The goal of Torizon is to make you very productive. So the idea is that you have something that it's ready to use. You don't have to build your image before you are able to do anything on your device. And you can focus on developing the application. That is usually what really gives the value to your solution. So this presentation is about Visual Studio Code. So, okay, maybe a good way to introduce it is to use it to do the presentation. Okay, here it is. This is Visual Studio Code, and I'm using one of its many extensions to show my presentation. As you can see, it right now it's not too fancy. It's just text, and also I'm using the light theme. Most of the people use the dark one, but actually the light theme is better if you do a presentation. It's a bit more readable, and also I'm quite old, so for my eyes, it's better to have a clear background. But let's show you what you can do with Visual Studio Code. Here we have an extension that is named VSCode Reveal, and can be used to basically translate this text that is marked down into a beautiful presentation powered by the Reveal.js JavaScript framework. So I've just activated the preview, and I can drag my presentation over here. Okay, and let's close this to have a bit more screen space. Okay, my PC is struggling a little bit because, of course, it's also broadcasting the video and everything, but here it is. Okay, I'm using Visual Studio Code to run this presentation. Of course, Visual Studio Code is not mainly a tool for presentations, but that was just a way to show you how flexible it can be. Before we start with the webinar, let's have a poll so I can figure a bit better my audience. This poll is about your knowledge of Visual Studio Code. So if you have never used it, or if you just, let's say, played using it, or if you already use it in your day-to-day work, and if you use it already using our Torizon extension. Okay, so those are the four options you have. I know that probably most of our friends in the US are quite tired hearing about polls and stuff, but this is a different kind of polls. Okay, we can close it, and so we can immediately check the results. Okay, we have quite some people already using it their, let's say, daily work routine, but also some people that are not completely familiar with the tool. In this presentation, as I say, it is going to be zero to hero, so we try to give you as much information as possible so you can really start being productive. But I hope that also people that already use it can learn something new. People using our extension, of course, are not so many, but yeah, this has been released just a few months ago. It's still kind of a work in progress for some features, so that's some way expected, but I hope that at the end of the presentation, more people are willing to experiment using it. Okay, so for the people that never used it or never heard about it, what's Visual Studio Code? My favorite definition is that Visual Studio Code is an editor on steroids. That means that it's born as a code editor, but using extension, as you can see from the presentation here, you can improve and increase its functionality. So it's a tool that you can adapt and extend depending on your requirements. Seems to be quite popular. We can see it here. I can switch back. This is the Stack Overflow developer survey. They got like 90,000 answers, so it's not covering the full developer community, of course, but it's already quite a good statistic sample. And as you can see, Visual Studio Code seems to be quite popular among software developers as their favorite development tool. And also, let's talk about Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code. The marketing from Microsoft did quite a good job in, let's say, confusing people. Probably that's the main purpose of marketing anyway, isn't it? And we have two products with a very similar name, Visual Studio and Visual Studio Code, but they are completely different things. Visual Studio, latest version is Visual Studio 2019, is a full-blown IDE. IDE means Integrated Development Environment. That means that out of the box, it provides all the tools you need to develop some kinds of applications. It provides an editor, it provides a build system, it provides a debugger, and provides ways to deploy and then also to ship your application to your customers. Visual Studio Code, on the other side, as I say, it's born as a code editor. So it's much more, let's say, limited in scope, but can be extended to reach more or less the same level of features you have from a full-blown IDE. The main difference you see here also on the slide is that if you have an integrated IDE, everything is, as the word say, integrated together, but basically someone else made some choices when designing the product. So you have a specified, well-defined build system, well-defined types of applications you can develop. In Visual Studio Code, on the other side, since everything is based on extensions, you may build many different kinds of, let's say, almost IDEs by assembling together different extensions and choosing the functionality you need for your specific requirements. So from this point of view, it's probably a bit more flexible. On the other side, it requires some effort on your side to build exactly what you need. Also in terms of development model and let's say concept, they are quite different. Visual Studio Code is, let's say, a traditional software project. I think the first version was in 2005, if I remember correctly. So it's, let's say, old school proprietary software. It's developed internally by Microsoft. It's still fully developed and they have quite a big development team around it. But basically all the development is driven by Microsoft. Visual Studio Code, it's born as a multi-platform tool. Visual Studio actually runs on your Windows. Visual Studio Code can run on Windows, Linux, and macOS. And also, the development model is a bit different. It's open source, and it's basically developed by a community. Of course, Microsoft developed the core of the editor. They also accept pull requests and everything from contributors. But since a lot of features is implemented by extension, everyone can implement his own extension. Many of them are also open source, of course. And change the behavior of the environment depending on what they want to do. So from this point of view, we can say that the development is more community driven. Let's move to let's say our efforts inside Visual Studio Code. As I said with Torizon, our goal is to make you productive. You want to develop a specific device. As we try to speed up your development by providing a computer model that you can just plug on your cardboard, simplifying hardware design and also all the concerns you may have over long-term maintenance and so on, we try to do the same on the software side. So we provide you an operating system that is ready to use, and we provide you development tools that increase your productivity. Our tool is basically the Torizon extension. Oops, it's opening in the background. You can see, let's switch to the page so we don't have to wait until it's loaded. You can find it in the Visual Studio Marketplace. We have two versions. They have the same name, Toradex Torizon Support. One is labeled also Early Access. Basically, we have this version that is the stable one, and the Early Access, it's close to a nightly build. We actually don't update it every day, but we update at least once per week. So depending if you want to use a more stable environment or if you want to experiment our latest features, you can choose one of the two. And what is this about? I am using Visual Studio Code for the presentation, so I already have the extension here. Here in the extension, for example, you can see the devices I have on my desk at the moment. And for each device, you can explore it and you can see how much memory we have available, how much space do we have. Oh, we have quite a long process list because it's running some stuff. We have all the different storage devices or virtual devices we have with the space we use. We can see which container images we have on the device. As I said, on Torizon, applications are running inside a container. So from our tools, you are going to package your application as a container and ship it on the device. And we can also see which containers are currently running on my board. We also have some nice features like you can open a terminal so you can directly connect to your device and see what's happening or do whatever you need to do. I can close this so the presentation is a bit more visible. Of course, the purpose of our extension is not just monitoring devices or something like that. It's also helping you during development. So later in this presentation, we are going to see the development related features. But in the meantime, we have a poll. It's about operating system, the operating system you use for development. As I said, our extension currently works on Windows and Linux. If you use one of the two, you have two options. You may also use both because it happens. You may need Windows for some tools and you use mostly Linux for development or vice versa. And if you use macOS, please check this option. We would like to figure out how many people use macOS for development in embedded so we can choose if we we can support our extension also there. Okay, I've been talking quite a lot already for a poll, so we can close it. Let's check the results. We see it's quite close between Windows and Linux, a bit more Windows users, and definitely the majority of the people are using both. We, oh, sorry for this, for this 2%, but we don't have a huge number of people using macOS. But anyway, if you really think it's useful to have our extension, please report your feedback so we can act on this. We can go back to the presentation now. And we can talk, as I said, the purpose of extension is allowing you to develop applications. We support three different languages and frameworks, but the distinctions are a bit blurred nowadays. We have Python, so you can use this very popular language to quickly develop applications. We support .NET Core, so if your background, as for me, it's mostly from Microsoft development tools. We support their, let's say, probably most popular framework here. And we support also C and C++. So if you need to write native code for performances or to access hardware, we support it. We support different build systems. We're going to go in the details a bit more later. We also support Qt, specifically Qt 5. So you can also use C and C++ to develop application that have. That's true also for Python. We support also Qt for Python, but we are going to talk about this later. In the meantime, another poll. I'm keeping you busy. And this poll is about languages. So which languages would you like to see supported in our toolset? You may be happy what we provide at the moment, or you may want something different. You may want JavaScript or TypeScript or Node.js, more, let's say, web development, even if JavaScript can be used for different kinds of applications. You may want to use Java. We have a partner that is TotalCross supporting a very interesting Java-based environment. Or you may want Go, or if you want something else, please go in the chat or in the questions and provide your feedback. Okay, we have been working through the list, so we can see the results now. Let's see. Oh, it seems that we made quite some people happy already with our selection. And among what we don't support, definitely JavaScript is very popular, but we have some Java developers. If you use Java, please have a look at TotalCross. They also did some webinar with us, so you can have an introduction about their toolkit, and it's quite interesting for if you want to use Java on our devices. Okay, let's go back to the presentation. And so we say from zero to hero. So zero is I don't have anything. I want to create an application, and I'm going to show you a demo. Of course, since we have limited time in the webinar and also logistically a bit tricky to do live demos, I have a video. I am going to start the video. Okay, let me start it.
Okay, here we are. As you can see, now I'm using a Linux machine. It's actually my main development machine. Yeah, as we said, Visual Studio Code, it's multi-platform. I'm still using Visual Studio Code, and everything you're going to see in this demo is going to work exactly in the same way on a Windows machine. So we want to create a new application. I can use F1 to open the command bar. This is where you interact with Visual Studio Code for all the commands that are not directly exposed inside the user interface. As you see, Torizon has some commands at this stage. And specifically, we have commands to create different kinds of application, ASP.NET, .NET, Python, and C and C++. We are going to create an ASP.NET application. Why not? Okay. That's not the most creative name ever. But okay, let's put it in the temp folder. I'm not going to keep it. It's just a quick demo. Here we have a template. We have a list of templates, sorry. Basically, those are the same templates you can use when you use .NET new command from the comma line. let's create a Blazor application. I'm honestly not a web developer. Here we can select the platform. Platform defines the architecture. We have 32, 64 bits. We're going to use 64 since we're going to run on a Verdin. We also have the Debian version. It can be Bullseye, it can be Buster. We still have platforms using Busters, Buster. But we are going to move to Bullseye for the official release of Torizon, so my suggestion is to use Bullseye. We also have different version of ASP.NET Core 3.1, that is the currently stable version, and we have 5.0, that it's already a release candidate, so it's going to become the stable version soon. Let's use 5.0, let's use some bleeding edge stuff. On 64 bits on Bullseye. Here we can select a user. It's not a good idea to run as root, not even inside a container. Our base containers provide a Torizon user that matches the Torizon user on the host OS in terms of IDs. And this is definitely helpful if you need to share something between the host OS and the container. So let's use the Torizon user. Okay, now the system is going to create my new application. It's populating the folder with all the things. This is the file used to launch the debugger. It's not so interesting. Let's look at some source code. This is the standard template that you can create using the .NET command line. The difference is that this is configured to be built and executed on Torizon, so you don't have to do anything specific to configure the build or the build system or the debugger. Okay, we need to restore some packages because, of course, the system creates only the source code. It's not restoring the dependencies. Okay, it's ready. So we can start debugging. When we start debugging, first the system is building my code. We're using C Sharp. C Sharp code is compiled, so we're going to compile and then publish the application. In .NET, basically, you have two stages. First one is building, that is the traditional build, and then you have publish, basically when all the resources needed by your application, in this case, we have also some HTML, some JavaScript, some CSS files, it's taken and put in a folder that can then be used to run the application. This is what we are going to deploy to our target. Now we can select the target. We're going to select our Verdin board. Of course, you're not forced to select every time. You can just configure your application to be deployed on a specific device. I'm just willing to show it. And as you can see here, we started building the container. This is the same output you would have from Docker build on the command line. And it's setting up packages, setting up everything we need to be able to run our application. This is going to take a few minutes. It's going to download some stuff from the network, so I'm going to accelerate this in the video. Okay, here we are. The system has built, deployed, and started our container. It has deployed our application, and now we are ready to debug it. So we have all the features you would expect from a debugger. It's the same as debugging your application on your local machine. So we can step into our code, we can go over it, and we can execute it. This is the regular debugging environment. If you have been developing .NET, a core application using Visual Studio Code, and you have been running them locally on your machine, that's exactly the same thing. So we can run our application, you see it's initializing, it's starting, and that's it. It's running. How can we see if it's running? Just let fire a browser. Here we are. Let me switch Visual Studio to this half of the screen. I don't remember the name of my device, but it's pretty easy. I can go here. Here you can see we have all the properties of the device, version of the OS, and so on. We also have the hostname, that is quite useful. So I can just paste the hostname. The application is running on port 5000. And it refused to connect, so it's running on the Verdin. Here we are, let's put the right name on this. Whoops. Oh. Copy and paste it. There we go. Okay, that's sweet. Okay, now my heart is beating again. As you can see, we can run the application. I can't talk too much about this because, as I said, I'm not a web developer, but if you are a web developer, you should appreciate how easy it is to build and deploy your application on an embedded device. And from here, you can do pretty much everything you will do if you're going to run your application on a server, on the cloud. Just be careful, resources may be a bit more limited.
Okay, so you have seen how you can create an application. You can see, you have seen how you can use a very popular development environment like .NET, that it's usually popular on PCs or even servers on the cloud on an embedded device. This is, let's say, a very, very rough diagram about how development should or works on Torizon. The idea is that we start by creating the application. This is what we have seen. Of course, checking that all the tools are running as expected. Then we need some features so we can start adding libraries and packages. I say libraries if you use C, C++, packages if you use Python or .NET. And also you can configure how your application is running on the target. We say, okay, it's going to run inside a container, but from a container, you can, for example, access some hardware devices, or you may want to store some data on the storage of the device and so on. Once you have defined this, you start writing your code, typically. So you start to implement your features. When you are finished implementing, you can build your code, you can deploy it to the target, and start debugging. Okay, everything works, we can move forward. But honestly, this never happened to me in my 20 years long career. Sometime I've been lucky, it was building at the first time, but honestly, everything running at the first time, unless it was something very, very small, never happened. What do you have to do? You have to go back, you have to fix your bugs, and then you go back, you build the code, and again, deploy and test. And this loop is spending quite a good share of your development time. So our goal in our extension is to make this loop as efficient as possible. That does not mean, unfortunately, that we are going to fix bugs for you. We can do that, but we are going to really minimize the dead times in between. So you don't have to launch a very long build and wait for a lot of time until the whole image is flashed again to test it. This is going to be much faster, and later on I'm going to explain why. Once you're done with this stage, so you are out of the loop finally, you can package your application as a container. We run containers. One good thing about containers is that you can put everything in your container and ship it as a real world container at the end. And this is exactly what you can do. You're probably not going to ship it to all your devices. You're going to ship it to test devices, to your internal tests, and then maybe some more extended testing, whatever. But at some point, you're ready to deploy it to all your devices. This is the feature we are also implementing in our OTA system. And when you're finished, usually you go back in another loop. That means implementing new features, because of course, your customers are requiring new features or improvement to what you already have. So we try to make this cycle as efficient as possible, so really to improve your productivity. Okay, to show the next step, we are going to use the demo. That's the same demo we have been showing in the previous webinar in September, but for the people who didn't attend it, we are going to quickly show a video now. It's basically an application built using different containers, and it's going from hardware access to local user interface, and also saving some data into a database. I can just start the video so you get a better idea.
Okay, let's start the demo by having a look at the hardware. Here we have a very simple small scale with a load cell. The load cell is connected to an amplifier with a kind of an SPI interface that we control using GPIOs
from our Xora board with an IMX8 QM. And here we have some very simple additional hardware, just a switch to start the waiting process, and a couple of LEDs to show if it succeeds or not. And this is just an off-the-shelf network camera that it's sending the image to our Qt application, showing the camera and also the results of the waiting and recognition process. Let's move to the software side. This is Portainer. Portainer is a tool that allows you to check which container are running on your system. We also provide it as part of our evaluation and demo images. As you can see here, we have 8 containers running. We have Portainer itself. We have the Qt application, that's Qt client. We have the container with the business logic that has been developed in Python using our IDE tools. We have Chronograph, that is a front end for the database. We're going to see it at the end of the presentation. We have a container where we have a TensorFlow Lite model, again running as a Python application. We have Weston, that is used to manage the graphic UI, the container that we use to access hardware, and InfluxDB, the database engine. And as you can see, for each container using the Portainer UI, we can see basically what's happening, see the logs and everything. Now let's try. So let's start by putting some vegetables on our scale. As you can see, just place them, push the button, and the system is going to recognize and weight our goods. Okay, that's cauliflower, that's the weight. Let's try with the broccoli, because of course we named the application Broccolinator, so should be able to recognize broccoli, and it did. You see, weight and type again. And now let's try without anything on the scale. And so our system is not able to recognize any known kind of vegetable, and it's just showing an error. And this is Chronograph, that is basically a front end that allows us to explore data inside an InfluxDB database. It's released by the same company. And here you can see we have a dashboard, so we can see over time, 12 hours in this case, the average weight of our vegetables. And also we have a list of all the events. As you can see, we should improve a bit the error messages. We also have all the measurements that we have registered. We need to stretch this a little bit, and you can see also the weight. The interesting part of this UI is, oh, we didn't have to write any code to have it. Basically, it was just a matter of configuration. With this frontend, you can basically create queries using this panel. You can select your table, you can select your fields. You can also use a query language that is similar to SQL. It's a bit different because in FluxDB it's mainly used to store time series, and here you can see you can also have a graphical view. So you can build this kind of dashboard basically with no programming at all.
Okay, let's move back to the presentation. I hope that gives you a better idea, and I hope that now it's clear why it's called Broccolinator. So the purpose of the application is recognizing different kinds of vegetables and also basically manage the whole process of weighting them, maybe in the future printing labels or whatever. Even if the demo is relatively simple, we have different kinds of technologies and we have different containers running. So we have a container managing the, let's say, low level hardware interfaces. So talking with the switch, the LEDs and the scale, and this is implemented in C++. So it's native code. We need to access hardware for some things. We need also some performances. So absolutely makes sense to use C and C++. We have a unique socket between this and the business logic. It's using UDP because we just need to transfer a very limited amount of information. And also local sockets are readable even if you use UDP. Here we have the business logic. This has been implemented using C# in .NET Core, and this is basically the component that makes the whole process running. So executing the different operations required, saving some information in the database, and providing information to the local user interface. The business logic talks with the Python web service that has been developed using Flask. This one is used to recognize the images, so it's basically able to tell the business logic if what's on the scale, it's broccoli or whatever kind of vegetable. This information is shared with the local user interface. This local user interface has been developed using Qt. That is a pretty good toolkit for local user interfaces. So in C++, and it talks with the business logic. How here we have REST, but actually it's also using a local socket and exchanging data using JSON as the data format. So as you can see, it's not a huge sample, but it's good enough to show different languages and how different containers can interact to each other. And we can develop each and every component. Actually, I did that using our Visual Studio Code integration. All the source, it's available on our GitHub repo. I think, yeah, you just got the link in the chat. So if you want to look in the code, feel free to do it. It's open source. I'm going to show it now when we talk about the different languages and development tools. Okay, let's start from Python. That is probably my favorite development language. In Python, we support remote debugging. So basically, you can write your Python code on your machine, and this is going to be deployed and debugged running on the target. As you may know, Python it's interpreted, so you don't need a build stage there, but it's working in a very efficient way. Usually in Python, you have a lot of things coming from the standard library, is the batteries included philosophy of Python, but you also have a huge ecosystem providing lots of packages that can be used to extend the functionalities. In our toolkit, you can install packages using PIP, that is the most popular package manager for Python, or you can use them as Debian packages. Using them, the Debian packages usually make sense when they include some native code, so you don't have to compile it when you install the package. You can also use scripts, I'm going to show it later, so you can basically install your packages in different ways. We also support Qt for Python, so if you want to use Python to develop your user interface, or maybe to develop some additional tools, for example, for configuration and so on, you can use it. We support widgets or QML, so feel free to choose the kind of UI implementation from Qt you prefer. So let me open. I use a nice extension again of Visual Studio that allow you basically to change the colors for each project. And it's very useful if you use multiple projects at the same time. So when you switch from one to the other, you realize immediately what are you working on. So this is a Python application. So we have our Python code. It's not super complex, as I said, but it's using Flask. Flask is a very popular framework to develop web application or web services. In this case, we are developing a web service. It's not meant to show anything inside the browser, but it's meant to be called from other things to perform some functions. And specifically, the function is going to perform is recognize images. We have this is, I left also the license because it's actually the demo code for TensorFlow Lite. TensorFlow Lite is a popular framework for machine learning. The full version, TensorFlow, it's very popular in the cloud or on PCs, on powerful machines. TensorFlow Lite has been adapted to run on more limited devices, and it actually runs on our models too. So basically, I had to create a model. You will also find it in the open source repo. I took a lot of pictures of my vegetables, and then I trained a machine learning model to recognize them. I included my model in my application code. It's just a binary file, so it's not so interesting. But in this way, I'm basically able to load it and use it to recognize images. First of all, the easy part. We use some Python packages. You can see the list here. Some packages that are already provided by Debian. So for those, I just use the Debian packages. It's much easier. They are easily installed inside the container. And usually Debian provides stable versions. So it's quite a good choice. But they don't provide a version for TensorFlow Lite. So I need to install it. And in your application, you can have setup script. And in this setup script, basically, I am downloading the TensorFlow Lite wheel from a Google server and then installing it inside my container. So even if you need to install something that's a bit more complex and not provided out of the box as a package, you can do this using the script. OK, that's pretty much it about Python support. And now we can have a poll. This poll is about which kind of Python application or features would you like to see supported by our extension. So basically, if you want to be able to create quickly a template for application like the one I'm showing, use Flask, so web application or web services. If you want to see a template for TensorFlow, so you don't have to install the runtime, can be already provided in the container without having to deal with this. Or if you want to use, for example, OpenCV for image recognition or something else. Again, if you want to have something else, please write in the chat or in the question window. Okay, I think we had already some time to answer, so we can switch to the results. Oh, here we have quite basically all the three options are quite popular. So yeah, we this morning we had slightly different results. We have probably to mix them, but yeah, the idea is that this kind of feedback is going to be used to basically generate our roadmap and our, let's say, backlog for our work. Okay, we can go back to the presentation and talk about the next development environment. And this is .NET Core. .NET has been around for many years already. Oh, I don't remember how many, but definitely more than 10, probably 15. It has been released from Microsoft as a development framework, mostly targeting Windows. At that time, Microsoft was the old Microsoft, completely closed, so it was working only on Windows. .NET Core has been released just a few years ago, but it's already at least five, if I remember correctly, and is the new Microsoft. It's multi-platform, it's open source. It's not providing 100% of the features of, let's say, the legacy framework that is still supported and maintained, of course, but provides some interesting features. You can use it to develop services, headless applications, and if you use ASP.NET, also, as we have seen in the first demo, to develop a front-end that you can access from the browser. This can also be an interesting solution for the user interface of your device. If you want to use .NET Core with our tools, you need to have the .NET SDK. You need the OmniSharp extension in Visual Studio Code. This is the default setup if you want to use .NET in Visual Studio Code. And then you can target ASP.NET or .NET Core. And again, as we have seen in Python, you can add additional packages and to implement more features. One interesting package is the package that allows you to access the hardware. I don't remember the name right now. Sorry for this. But if you go to our GitHub repo, on GitHub, search for Toradex, we have a repo named samples, and inside this one you can see samples about GPIO, and there is one for .NET that really shows this library. This library can be used to access hardware, GPIO, I2C, SPI, and I don't remember what else, but it's already providing you quite some features that you can easily integrate. It's open source, but it's maintained and developed by some Microsoft developers, so probably it's going to be here to stay for .NET. Let me show you some .NET code, some C# code actually. Here it is. And this is our business logic. Our business logic, it's a .NET Core application, just a console application. You see we have our main. Of course, don't look at this as an example of how to structure your real application. This is a very small sample, but we have some classes basically to manage communication with the different parts of the system. So we talk with the hardware, let's say the hardware management container. We talk to the UI, so we have an output socket to send updated information to the UI. We can have also multiple UIs, like a local one or a remote one. We also talk with the web service that we have just seen for image recognition. So basically, in our business logic, we wait until someone is pressing the start button, the physical button you have seen in the video, and then we send some commands to the hardware management service just to show that we are processing the image. We talk with the image recognition service, and at the end we are going to get a tag. It's going to be vegetable name or null. If it's null, we are not able to recognize it, so we store an error in our database. We tell the UI to show error message, and so on. If we were successful, we read the weight. So we talk with the scale from the hardware management container. When it's finished, we can show the weight. And this is also going to be shown on the UI. As you can see, it's very simple. If you want, you can look deeper in the code in our GitHub repo. One interesting thing about this application, or a couple of things. We need to we need to use .NET, but as you can see, I'm not installing anything extra because we have a platform for .NET, so it came with the runtime already installed. If you don't use .NET, of course it's not there, but if you use .NET, we provide a container where it's already set up, so you don't have to do anything about this. Here we are accessing the temp folder on our device. This is needed because we have multiple applications talking over sockets, and to have a socket we need a file system, and we need to use the same file system, so we need to use the actual file system on the host OS. Second thing I would like to show is that we have a Docker Compose file. Docker Compose is a tool that you can use basically to start multiple containers and synchronize the startup and the communication between them. In this case, we start a couple of containers to use InfluxDB, that is an event database. If you need to store time series information, so data tagged by time, it's a very good tool. And we also have a chronograph, that it's a UI to see that data. Okay, that's pretty much it about .NET. And let's move to the poll. In this poll, we're going to, again, discuss the different features of the .NET framework, and asking you how you are currently using .NET. So if you develop PC application using the full .NET framework, WPF or Windows Forms, if you already use .NET Core, if you use ASP.NET, so mostly web development, or if you're using the .NET Compat framework that was still supported on Windows CE. Okay, I think we can close the poll. Let's check the results. Okay, quite some people are using the .NET framework on PCs with the UI, not so many ASP.NET. Okay, thank you for the feedback. We can move forward with the presentation. I am already a bit late, sorry for this. Let's talk about the last language or set of languages, is C and C++. I know that C++ developers consider C++ something different compared to C and vice versa, but at the end, you have a compiler, you have include files, so the environments are quite similar. What we do with C and C++ to make you, again, more productive is to provide you a container also on your development machine. Visual Studio Code has a very cool feature, a feature named remote containers, so you can run everything inside the container. In this container, we set up the toolchain. Usually, setting up the toolchain and all the build-related tools is quite time-consuming on every machine. And you also need to be sure that the toolchain is not changing over time, because this can change the way your code is compiled and maybe the end results. Running in a container allows you to have your dedicated environment, and that's it. And also inside your container, you can install additional libraries and so on. We support different build systems. We support, let's say, old school make files. We support AutoMake. We support CMake. So let's say the most popular environment in C++. And we also support QMake because this is required to support development for Qt. Let's quickly see an example. This is our service to access the hardware. Again, let's switch to the file view. It's a very simple application. It's basically initializing some hardware interface depending on the kind of modules we are using. We need to use different pins. And then we basically have a loop. We wait on the socket that is talking with the business logic. So basically we wait for commands from the business logic, as you can see, like get the wait. And we also wait. The only other event is when someone pushes the switch that is used to start the whole process. But this is quite important because it's what is triggering the whole thing. Again, you can go on GitHub and see the full source and go inside it. And if you have any question, you can go on community.toradex.com, or you can use GitHub directly by opening issues or interacting with us using it. Okay, I wanted to show that we are running inside a container. Actually, this is a terminal and I'm running inside a container. This is pretty easy because I'm running on a Windows machine and this is Linux, so it's pretty easy to prove. And in this container, I have my development environment already set up. So let's caps lock by mistake. Let's do this. Okay. And as you can see here, we already have the compiler set up for the architecture we want to target. How do we configure additional libraries? If we need an additional library, in this case, we use libgpiod, that it's a very good library to access GPIO. We need the library on the runtime, on the device, so on the container we are going to deploy on the device, but we also need the development library, the one that provides the header files and everything. And this one is in dev packages. It's installed inside my development container. As you can see here, we have also the architecture because we use Debian, and Debian has a very good support for multi-architecture. So just specify the suffix and it's going to install the right library in the right place. We need to access GPIO, so our user needs to be added to the GPIO group. You can see the command here. It's just the command we put in the Docker file at the end. And we need to share still the temporary folder, as I explained before. And also we need to share all the GPIO devices. This way you can access GPIO pins from inside the container. You don't access hardware from a container by default, but you can enable it. So it's just up to you to set it up in the right way. We also support Qt. I'm running short on time, so I'm not going to show the code here, but basically you will see it on GitHub. The main feature is that since we are not using Qt Creator, you can edit your UI or QML file directly from Visual Studio Code by opening the container, but then you can use it for the UI file and still build and run and debug your code using Visual Studio Code. And I wanted to show you the last video, the last demo. This one is showing you, okay, we had a quick overview of our four containers. And now in the demo, I'm going to show you, how you can be able to actually debug them running on target. Let me start the video. And later we will have time for questions and to finish the, to wrap up the webinar.
Okay, so now we are ready to debug our code. As we have seen, we have multiple containers, multiple languages, multiple runtimes. Let's start from the low level. So this is a project that talks with the hardware. You will be able to find the code on GitHub. So if you want to have a more deeper look into it, feel free to do it. Here we are running on an Apalis, we use MX8. Maybe if you want to set up the same thing, you need to change some pins or whatever. But let's quickly look into the code. Basically, we have a common socket that it's a class that is defined inside the application that it's used to communicate with the business logic. Then we have three small classes used to manage communication with the sensor that it's actually used for the scale. And here you can see the code we are using to access it. I'm not going deep into this because we don't have time, but it's online. So if you want to learn something more about this, feel free to do it and feel free to send us questions or maybe report some bugs. Let's also check how the application is configured. Here we have our configuration. And what's important here is that we share a folder, we share the temp folder, basically because this is where we create the sockets we use to communicate between the different containers. And inside this container, since we have to access hardware, we share also the different GPIO chips. We have five on the IMX8. Another thing that is nice to check, it's what we do when we build our container. We add the Torizon user to the GPIO group, and we add some additional libraries, some libraries to the runtime. This is libgpiod, that is the library we use to access the GPIO, and we also use the minus dev version for ARM64, so for the architecture we are using, and this is using during build. As we already explained in the presentation, when we use C and C++, we run inside a container that has the whole development environment. This also helps with features like IntelliSense and so on, because in this way you can immediately have your have some help when you're typing function names or something like this. For example, if I go in this file, you see I'm using the GPIOD, I can do GPIOD underscore and see all the different functions. And when I choose a function, I can also see its parameters. Now I'm just deleting this to not add some additional bugs in my code. Let's quickly look at the code. Basically, we have some initialization. And at this point, we are basically waiting for commands from the business logic. We don't have so many commands. Oh, we have also a spelling mistake here. Let's fix that. The first one, it's basically used to connect the business logic to this component. It's just for information. Then we have commands that toggle the LEDs. So if everything is okay or something went wrong. We have a command that we use at the beginning of image recognition to clean the state of the LEDs. And this is the command we are interested in. Okay, we can put a breakpoint here because this is where in the code the business logic requires the current weight of the thing that it's on the scale. And we are going to follow this with the debugger. This one instead is connected to the switch, and basically this event is going to be set when someone is pushing the switch. And so we can put also a breakpoint here, because this is basically where the whole waiting and recognition sequence starts. Okay, as you can see here, we do a select, so basically we wait until something happens. So when we start this application in the debugger, I'm putting a breakpoint also here, I can start it. The application is going to be deployed. As you see, it's quite fast because we already built and deployed the container. This happens only the first time, or when you change some configuration. Okay, now I can step over this statement, and you will see that we are stuck here because nothing is happening. Okay, we deployed and started our first application. Let's move to the second one. This one is the service that is doing the image recognition. It's implemented in Python. It's using Flask, probably. Many of you already know it. Flask is a framework to develop web applications or to develop services that expose a REST-based API. And this is what we are doing. Actually, this code is basically taken from the sample that is provided with TensorFlow Lite. So it's really nothing too crazy. It's well explained and documented this there. But basically, we have different kind of requests to recognize images. One of them is passing a URL. This is what we use, because basically, since we use a network camera, that is this guy here, we can just tell the service, okay, get the image from the camera directly. Okay, so we can put a breakpoint here, and this is simply the main, the entry point that runs the server. And here we have the actual image recognition part. As you can see, I kept the original license because this is taken directly from the TensorFlow Lite documentation. It's not super efficient, honestly. It's loading the model, everything, every time, but honestly, we are not interested into performances here. And anyway, this takes a few milliseconds. Okay. As you can see here, in my project, I also have the labels, so I can recognize broccoli and tomato, and the model. The model also, sorry. It's not, it's just a binary file, so we can't see anything too interesting there. But basically, the model has been created by training it using some images. So basically, I took many images using the same camera, of course, of my plastic broccoli. In the previous demo, I used the real ones, but my office has been stinking for 1 week. So for this one, we are going to use the plastic ones. I took many pictures in different positions, and basically the system takes those pictures. Some are used to train the recognition and other to test if it's actually working. And through an iterative process, it's generating this model. So if you want to, let's say, play with image recognition or something like this, this is really easy to do. You will find also this folder inside the GitHub repo, so you can see how we did that. It's not super optimized. If you need to do advanced thing with image recognition, we have partner that can help you. Okay, that's pretty much it. As you see, we don't have any specific requirements in this application. No, the packages are installed using Debian. And here you see we install the, basically the packages that are required by TensorFlow. NumPy, we use Flask, the Python image library, and we also use VGET. And I'm showing you why we need VGET, because basically TensorFlow Lite is installed using this script that it's part of the project. When you create a project, it's usually empty, but we put some code there. And we basically download the TensorFlow runtime from a server from Google and install it locally. So the first time you build the container is going to take a bit, because of course installing TensorFlow Lite takes some time. But yeah, after you build and deploy it, it's the same thing. So I can start it, and now it's running. Okay, it started. Okay, our server is ready to receive requests. We can put also this one to the side. Let's move to the business logic, that it was what is basically driving the whole system. For this one, we need only the temp folder, because we use two sockets, one to talk with the hardware, the Broccolinator hardware application, the other one to talk with the user interface that we are going to see immediately after. Okay, this is developed in .NET, so it's the third language we see during this demo. Here again we have a couple of classes to manage in commands to the hardware side, sending information to the UI. We use image recognition, basically we send an HTTP request and parse the results. And we also have a database, because basically we're using FluxDB to store information about the recognition and to keep data about our activity. Okay, as you can see here, let's go quickly so we can, we can just start the debugger, and we will then follow it as long as it's running. Okay, let me just put a breakpoint here so we can start debugging. Okay, here we are. You have seen that I already hit a breakpoint here. Let me close this one. Okay, basically we exit from the select, because when starting the command socket, we send this connect command. So we can go through this. Okay, you will see. Oh, this is a bit constrained, but yeah, you see that we are connected. We can press F5 again. And now let me remove the breakpoint. We're not interested in the other events. Okay, so we have also the business logic running. Let me keep it freezed for a moment because we can start the last component, that it's the user interface. Move this to the window. Okay. As you can see, I have different corals here. It's an extension named Peacock. And it's quite useful when you use multiple projects, because for each project you can use a color. But unfortunately, I have two tones of yellow, and I use the wrong one now. Okay, this is a cute application. It's basically showing a window. It's getting continuously the images from the network camera. And it's also using another thread to get messages from a socket. In this case, we are using a stream socket. We are using YAML as the data format. So we are going to receive more, let's say, complex messages. Okay, we can put a breakpoint here. This is when we actually receive our message. Another thing, we have some UI, and if you want, you can edit using Qt Designer. So we can visually design the UI, even if you're not using Qt Creator, that it's Qt official tool for development. Okay, I can start also this one. Let me start it. I was saying here, you can see the output on the screen of my device. The application has been started. As you have seen, we started Weston, that is the graphical server. This is done automatically when I'm debugging a Qt application that needs graphics. We can run the application and you will see the main window appearing on the screen. Here it is. Okay. You see the image from the camera. We enhanced contrast to improve the recognition, so it's not a very nice image, but hopefully it should work for recognition. Okay, we are ready to start our full cycle. So let's grab some vegetables, put them on the scale, put it on the scale. Okay, here it is. I can just push this button, and this is going to start the recognition process. So we got a message here, but it's not yet the right one. Let me push the button. Okay, you see, I hit a breakpoint in the hardware, Broccolinator hardware application. Okay, we don't need any other event from the button. We prepare an event for the business logic, and we send it to the business logic. And now we can keep running. Let's switch back to the business logic. Here we wait until we get the start event, but of course we just push the button so it's already there. And we start waiting, the waiting sequence. The first thing we do, we send a command to turn off the two LEDs, but they are already off. And here we process our image. So when we process the image, we hit the breakpoint in the Python application that it's actually doing the processing. And here you can see, I can again step, follow all the operation performed by TensorFlow and blah, blah, blah. In this case, it's an HTTP request, so I don't have too much time to go into the details, otherwise it's going to time out. But I can just press F5, and when it's finished, you will see that we have recognized something. So we got the result from the call. We can keep running here. We send another command to read the weight from the scale. And then we wait until we get a response. Okay, we need to wait our thing. Let's do it. It's 10 grams, send back the answer. And you see here, we are back into the business logic. Let's move forward. The business logic is just printing out some information here. And then we are going to save this in the database. I'm not going into the code. It's just in FluxDB. And now we are sending the results to the UI. So when I step over this instruction, I'm sending data over the socket. And, oops, here we are still waiting. Let me switch to the Qt application now. And you see, also this one has hit a breakpoint. honestly, sometimes, depending on what you're doing, sometimes Visual Studio Code keeps following in the same window. Other time, as you've seen before, activates another window. This is a bit annoying, but still we are debugging four things at the same time. So I think it's acceptable. And here we got a measurement. So we read the information from it and so on. And at the end, we are going to see the information displayed on the UI. Okay, so it was a small demo, of course, of a simple application, but the idea here is to show you how powerful this is. You can follow your events between four different containers, different languages, different applications, and using the same tool. Okay, this is very powerful if you need to develop this kind of solutions, and I think that more and more often you're going to see this on embedded devices.
Okay, let's switch back. Okay, sorry if the video was taking a bit more time than what we planned for this session, but I hope that we also provide quite some content. I think we have a last step here. Basically, once you're done developing and debugging your application, if you are ever done debugging a software application, but whatever, when you're ready to release something, you can build a release container. So during development, we don't put the application inside the container. We just keep it on a folder on the host file system and share it inside the container so we can quickly update it without having to redeploy the whole container at a time. But when you want to ship it, containers are very good just because you can put everything inside and just ship it. So this is what happens when you build the release version. Then you probably want to publish this container on a registry. You can use Docker Hub or you can use your private one. If you want to integrate with our OTA feature, you can also deploy containers and updates through the OTA. Those last two functions are not there yet in our toolkit. You can already build the release container. As I said, we are still working on it. It's a work in progress. But I hope that if you start developing your application using it, by the time you are ready to release, we are going to have those features ready. Okay, that's pretty much everything about the content. We have quite some questions, so I'm going to reply to the questions right now. Of course, if you maybe have other things scheduled, you have to leave, but we are going to provide a recording of the webinar, so if you ask the question and you are not able to reply when you are still online, you are going to find this information in the recording. You can also go on community.toradex.com and ask any question you want about Torizon there. It's free support, and we will try to reply as soon as possible. So thank you everyone for the time, but I'm still here. So now you will see I'm not going to look in the screen, but I'm going to look on my other PC, other screen for the questions, but I will try to reply. So let's start with the questions so we don't waste more time. Let's start from the beginning, sorry. Okay. Do you plan to add Visual Studio Code extension also for application development based on the Toradex Yocto BSP? We don't have any specific plan at the moment. Consider that mostly if you're working on Linux, because the tools runs there, you can use already the C and C++ extension of Visual Studio to build native code for Linux. You will have to set up the toolchain yourself, but from Yocto, okay, so you can easily install it, and also you need to build an image with the debugger. We just need GDB server, so I think it's not too hard to integrate. But at the moment, we don't provide this. We don't have plan. But of course, if we have requests, maybe we can consider this for the future. Can Torizon extension also work on WSL? I mean, actually, you need to install WSL to use it. Sorry, I forgot to mention this. We use it for some features like rsync, but the extension can run also on Windows, and it provides exactly the same features. You can theoretically do this by installing it on Linux, then using an X server for the UI, but honestly, you don't need to do this. You can just run it natively on Windows, and it's providing the same features. Okay, this is already applied. How is Torizon integrated with Yocto into Visual Studio Code? I cannot see any mention of Yocto. Basically, we use Yocto to build Torizon Core itself. All our layers, our configuration for Yocto, it's open source. You can find it on GitHub on in the Toradex account. But for application development, we run inside containers and we use Debian. So basically, what we have seen here, it's actually building an application for a Debian container. And this is the way we would like to see people shipping their application on Torizon. So as I said before, we don't have an integration with the underlying OS image that is built with Yocto. But if you need to customize this, it's open source, so you can do this. There is available documentation for the whole list of parameters of the container configuration. I mean, the other like extra packages. This is still work in progress. We need to improve the documentation, I recognize. On the other side, to write the documentation, we need to have the features that are working. So, but we are working on this. I hope it's going to be available soon. If you have any question, just go on community.torizon.com and we will try to reply. Are graphical user interface possible with .NET Core? Unfortunately, Microsoft itself is not supporting any kind of UI like WinForm or WPF. Those are only for Windows and for the, let's say, full-blown desktop version. There are some projects working on this. One solution can be running a web-based UI locally on your machine through a browser. And there are some frameworks like Avalonia that may work, but honestly, at the moment, we don't have a ready-to-use solution for these specific requirements. We have UI for Python and C and C++, no local graphic UI for .NET, let's say officially supported at the moment. Can Visual Studio run in Linux? No, can't. If you mean the full-blown Visual Studio 2019, Visual Studio Code, yes, of course. In order to use the early access version of the extension, should I uninstall the stable one? Yeah, good question, because I didn't mention this. But yes, you need to uninstall the stable one and use the early access. You cannot have them both at the same time. Sorry for this. Okay, what is the typical container size? Our base container, so just the minimal set of features we need from Debian, it's 25-30 megabytes. So if you develop C applications, everything on top of this, it's your fault. It's you adding libraries or something like this. If you use Python, I'm just going through my memory, so don't take this for granted. But if I remember correctly, it should be around 50-60 max. If we talk about .NET, we go up to 70 megabytes for .NET 3.1. We also provide .NET 5, but honestly, I didn't check the size for this, but you can just go on Docker Hub and check our containers. What is a container? We did a webinar in September about this. So the best thing, if you go to our website into the events session, I think you can find the recording, and it's also posted here in the answers. I had some configuration issues with VS Code on Windows. What is Moses? Moses is basically, since we support multiple IDEs, we have also support for Visual Studio on Windows. We have a backend that is implementing quite a good set of the features, so we don't have to maintain two different full set of features in the two extensions. And this backend is named Moses. So if you see moses.exe or Moses without extension on Linux, that's the IDE backend. If you have configuration issues, please write on the community website and we will try to help you as soon as possible. What about including third-party libraries in VS Code, for example, the EtherCAT master from Acontis, which was presented in the last webinar? This consists of pre-compiled libraries, closed source, which needs to be linked. is possible at all. Everything that is provided as a Debian package can be installed directly by adding these extra packages. If you have something that is not in the Debian repo, what you can do, if you have the binaries, you can just copy them into your source code folder and reference them locally. If you use our build system, the whole folder is shared into the container, so you can link them. If you need to provide them also in the runtime container, so it's not a static library, it's a dynamic one, you can do the same. Depending on the build system you use, can be make file, can be CMake, or auto make. You just need to deploy the library together with your application. So if you have an install step in your make file, or you provide the, how it's called, targets to CMake, just add this library there, and it's going to be deployed, and it can be used. Also, if you have header files and everything, just put them in local folders, add them to the include part of your project, and they are going to be recognized also by IntelliSense and all those features. Where is the information how to run a few container? All of them container are connected. It's localhost 8080. I don't really get the question. I mean, if you need to run multiple containers at the same time, for example, if you want to run our Broconiator demo without debugging it, what you can do is to create a Docker Compose file. Basically, with a Docker Compose file, it's a YAML file, it's a text file. You can define which containers do you want to run, which things you need to access from the local system, which ports you want to share, so you can create your configuration and then use this to run all the containers at the same time. For .NET Core development, Visual Studio Code is great, but we would much rather to use the Visual Studio IDE. Any plans to support that? This is an objection I heard quite sometimes. To be honest, extending and developing extension for Visual Studio Code is much, much faster and easier. So for us, adding new features to Visual Studio Code in terms of effort, it's really, really lower than full-blown Visual Studio. A full-blown Visual Studio has a quite old extension model. It has been evolving over time through, I don't remember how many versions. And so it's quite hard to integrate with this system. Also having a fully integrated build system and deploy and makes integration quite more challenging. So we had a few requests. If those few requests grow to many, many, maybe we can put some effort into this, but at the moment, what we support is Visual Studio Code. How to debug in the Qt environment? It's the same as debugging C and C++ applications. So just press F5 in Visual Studio Code, your application is going to be built, deployed on the device. If you use our template, so when you create an application, you can choose a template. The Qt templates already start everything you need for the graphical UI. That means our Western server, a Western compositor that it's used for rendering the UI. So really it's just the same thing as debugging a standard C++ application. With .NET Core, is hardware interaction fully supported, including GPIO, interrupts, SPI, SQC, ADC, PWM, etc.? What library do you use for this? There is a library, it's called .NET Core IoT, something like this. Sorry, I don't remember the name at the moment. But if you search also on the .NET Core blog, they have an article about this from some time ago. And it provides features to access, for sure, GPIO, I2C, I remember. I'm not sure about the other interfaces. For sure, you cannot receive an interrupt directly. What you can do is you can wait until a GPIO changes state, and this is done through libgpiod, and at the end it's relying on interrupt in the kernel, so can also be efficient. If you check on our GitHub account, we have a repo for samples for Torizon, and there is a folder named GPIO, and there is a .NET folder there that shows exactly this. So you can check and see which library we use and how it's implemented. Is the container based in Docker? Yes, we use the Docker runtime. So we use Docker on your machine to build, so it has to be installed. And then we also use Docker on the target to run the container. If you use Docker, what is the benefit of Torizon over lightweight container embedded Linux like Oryx? There are multiple container runtimes. RANSI, Podman are quite popular too. At the moment, we support Docker because it's the one for which you have more documentation. And also some of the container runtimes don't provide all the features Docker does provide. For example, building the container, it's more complex. Or it does not provide a way to download a new version of your container locally, or using overlayFS to reduce the overall usage of storage by the different containers and so on. So at the moment, to use Docker, we don't fully depend on it. So in theory, we can change it. But at the moment, we decided to support Docker because it's the most popular one. It's possible to use Visual Studio 2019 with Toradex, yes. We have an extension also for Visual Studio 2019. In this case, we support only C and C++ development. So for Python and .NET, we provide support for those languages only on your Visual Studio code. How does Torizon differ from other solutions in the open source space like Ajax? Honestly, I don't know ExtraJects specifically. I'm going to check immediately after the webinar. I mean, there are other solutions to run a embedded Linux system with a container runtime. Also Fedora IoT from Red Hat. We try to not be tied to any specific Linux vendor, like Red Hat, for example, even if the solution is quite good. Torizon also provides over-the-air update support, and the OS itself is fully open, so you can also customize it and change it. Honestly, I cannot do a specific comparison with what you mentioned because I don't know it in detail. Would it be feasible to implement the Broccoli demo application only using C and C++ as a single, easy-to-manage application? Yeah, I mean, why not? I would probably not fully agree about this single easy to manage part. Because, for example, if you need to implement also the local UI, then you probably need to use Qt or GTK or something like this. So you have already a quite heavy framework into your application itself. And for example, Qt cover all the features. So you write Qt code, it's no longer C and C++. Also for some things, like for example, providing a web service, Python, it's definitely efficient. And the overhead of having Python is not that big, not in terms of resource usage. It can fit on all our modules. And also in terms of performances, the actual part of the elaboration that is done by Python code is so small that the overhead by network communication and so on, it's really not relevant. So you can do this definitely. If you feel more comfortable, do this. My approach would be to choose the right tool for the right thing. So depending on the different parts, you may have a web service, you have web-based UI, you have something where you need performances. You can also mix different languages, up to you. At the end, you can also run a single container with a single process inside it, and it's like running this process on top of the base OS itself. Is there a way to develop and deploy on a local developer machine, Linux x86, without having the hardware? You develop on an x86 machine anyway. You need to have a device. In the early access version, we support Torizon devices, but also we call community devices. So if you have, for example, a Raspberry Pi that has SSH access and Docker runtime on it, then you can use it with our tools. So you don't need a Toradex board to experiment with those tools. You can use also different Linux system as long as it's ARM32 or ARM64. It provides SSH. This is usually a basic requirement, and also it has a Docker, the Docker runtime. If you have this, you can use different hardware, but you need a device. What's the amount of memory used on target to run this demo? Oh, I didn't do the math, but we talk about the container size, the hardware control, it's really a very small application. Also, the business logic is not that complex, so we are talking about the same size we discussed before. The only one that is definitely slightly bigger is the TensorFlow one, because the TensorFlow runtime itself is probably around 50 megs. So this definitely increases the size a little bit. But in total, I would say it's nothing that can... this demo can probably run on any other module that has at least half a gig of RAM, and all of them have 4 gig of storage. So I'm pretty sure that it can run on all the modules that match those requirements. What if we decide to use an unsupported language like Rust? Basically, it's a matter of configuring a container hosting the runtime and figuring out how you can remotely debug into it. This is what we did already for some languages. I honestly didn't look into Rust yet, so I don't know specifically to give more instruction. But in Visual Studio Code, for sure, many languages support remote debugging. So once you have this, it's a matter of taking the Debian image, our base Debian image, install actually, Rust, you don't even need the runtime, you build everything. So you need to deploy your Rust application and maybe mount the folder inside the container and figure out how to make remote debugging work. Is there a roadmap regarding supported languages? There is not, because at the moment we are working on what we provide. If we put some new languages, then definitely we are going to provide at least, target about when support is going to be available. What is the name of the software used to compile and transfer software to the GPU? Actually, we use Docker to build the container, and then we use rsync to synchronize files. It's possible to develop app with Qt that use EGFL KMS without Windows Manager, Nate X11 or Wayland. We did some experiments around this. It's not the default configuration we provide in our templates, but if the hardware platform you run on support this configuration, you can probably configure a container that does this and build your Qt application to run inside it. It's not something we support out of the box. How is the workflow for Torizon to use a display with touch, GPIO, and the mini PCI Express slot with the CAN mini PCI interface to develop HDMI? This is a bit complex. We can support some additional hardware. Some of our modules support CAN natively, so maybe you don't need this PCI interface, but depending on what you need to do. If you need to do, customize the hardware configuration, we support changing our device tree. It's a feature that we are still working on, but if you search on our developer website, you can find all the information about this. With Python on an Xora cardboard with a Palis, you can definitely use, this is a combination that definitely works. I was actually used an MX8 on a Palis MX8 on an Xora. How do you develop, how do you set up SPI or I2C for using an application? Basically, also for SPI and I2C, it's just a matter of sharing the devices into the container. We also have standard names for them. So I2C 1, 2, 3, it's always matching the pinout of the module. You also need to add your user in the container to the right group. And we mirror the groups in the host OS and the container. So you can just check which, I don't remember honestly, which group it's owning the different interfaces. For I2C, it's I2C actually, and add the user. Same thing we did for GPIO. How big is Torizon? I don't have an immediate answer, honestly. You can check on our developer website. But if I remember correctly, the whole OS, it's 200 something max, but I'm just relying on my memory and it's not super reliable. What is the CPU overload when using Docker over native Linux application running on the target? The overhead is zero. If you make a OS call, a kernel call, the path you follow from inside the container is exactly the same path you follow from a user mode process. So in this point of view, the overhead is zero. We discussed this a bit more in our webinar about containers, so maybe it's a good idea to watch it. And there we go a bit deeper into the architecture and explaining why, specifically for CPU access, the overhead is zero. You may have some overhead in terms of storage and memory, but in terms of performances, no. Okay, our last question was about getting the recorded webinar. We are going to provide it in a few days. Usually it's in the event session on our website, so you're going to be able to download it soon. So if you don't have any more questions, I think we can wrap it up. Sorry for the extra time. I hope it was useful for answering some additional questions. And again, if you have any feedback, any question, you can reach out to us through our contacts, or you can go on the community website, that it's again community.toradex.com, and find information. We also have developer.toradex.com, where you can find quite some documentation about Torizon and all our products. Documentation for these specific features is still work in progress, but be patient. We are going to update it frequently, and hopefully in a short time we are going to provide much better documentation. Thank you very much for your time, and see you for the next webinar.